Without much further ado, there are mics on the aisles. I will suggest that if you want to ask question, rather than to wait for me, you can queue up, yeah, and then be able to pose a question. Just give me your name and be concise to the topic. If there is a misconception on the misconception of Islam, then I'll tell you you're out of line. Yeah. Okay. Fine.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Yes. My name is Zaini, and I would like to ask one question regarding about the Bible and the Quran itself. Which is, can you prove in the Bible and the Quran, which is in the Quran that says that, if you say that Islam is a religion of peace, so why is it, why Allah saying that he curses the Jews itself, whereas in the Bible, it doesn't state that it curses the Arabs, for instance. So that's my question.
The brother asked a question that as compared to Quran and Bible, in the Quran, he says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala curses the Jews. And in the Bible, you don't find that God Almighty is cursing the Arabs. Whether, if you analyze and read the Quran, that suppose anyone makes a mistake, it's the duty of the teacher to correct that person. And if he's at fault, that person requires a scolding. So if you read the Quran in several places gives examples of the Jews. The Jews were the chosen people. Jews were the chosen people. If you analyze in the glorious Quran, 25 prophets are mentioned by name. Majority of them, most of them, they are Jewish prophets. Jewish prophets. You will find very few which are non-Jewish. So Jews were the chosen people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah says, I have given you so much ni'mat, I have chosen you, yet you do not do the job. So Allah gives the answer. In Surah Muhammad, chapter 47, verse number 38, Allah says, "Wa in tatawallaw." If you do not do the job, Allah will substitute in your place another people. And they will not be like you. So Allah said, the Jews were the chosen people. They didn't do the job. Allah said, you go out and bring the other people. Now, the Arabs were looked down by the Jews. The Jews looked down the Arabs. These people, these ignorant people, what will they tell us something? What's the use of telling them about the religion? So Allah says, those who you look down upon, Allah make those people to sit on your head. And the Arabs, which are ignorant people, Allah, by the revelation of the Quran, made them the torchbearers. So, those who do not follow the instruction, Allah says, don't be like them. Allah says, woe to the scandalmonger. Allah doesn't only curse the Jews, Allah curses all the people who are wrong. Like, for example, Surah Humaza, chapter 104, verse number 1. وَيْلُلْ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. Woe to every kind of scandalmonger and backbiter, irrespective of whichever religion he follows. Even if he's so-called Muslim, if he backbites, Allah says, woe to them, curse them. Anyone who doesn't follow Allah's commandment, abstains and goes against Allah's commandment, Allah doesn't like them. The question is, why didn't God Almighty in the Bible curse the Arabs? Because when the Injil was being revealed, Injil is the wahi which was given to Isa alayhi salam, and Torah is the wahi which we believe, which was given to Musa alayhi salam. The present Bible is not the Torah or the Injil which we believe in. It's not in original form. But whatever form it's in, yet at that time, the Arabs were not the chosen people. So when Arabs were not the chosen people, how can he curse them? How can God curse them? For example, I'm a teacher and I've taught 100 people, you know, of people living in Bombay, you know. And suppose if you don't know subject well, how can I come and curse the Singaporeans? You are not those people who are attending my class. So similarly, Allah chooses the Jews. So when he has chosen the Jews at that time, the Arabs were not the chosen people. So the question of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cursing them doesn't arise. But otherwise in the Bible, Allah curses many other people who have done wrong. Hope that answers the question.
Yes, sister.
Why Islam is, as you mentioned earlier, is a fastest growing religion. Being a Chinese, we talk about the square. Square means the four corners of the world. And I do not know who have created this symbol. And Islam is a double square. So it's inevitable, no matter what the West try to do, there's no way they can do anything, because from day one, Allah knows that He will reach the four corners of the world. Not only four, but eight. Thank you.
That's a very good question. She asked that, why is Islam the fastest growing religion in the world? Why is it spreading so much? You know, though the Western world, however much they try to attack Islam, they will not be able to do it. Why is it spreading? Sister, the reason is, as I said in my talk, that Islam is the most logical way of life. It is the only religion which is based on complete truth. And even the Western world, you know, they say, you know, the major attacks of the Western world about Islam is on women in Islam. Therefore, out of 20 questions, 5 are based on women's rights in Islam. You know, they attack Islam maximum on the women's rights. And do you know, sister, that today, amongst the Americans that convert to Islam, 60%, more than 60% are women. It's an irony that the Western world is saying Islam doesn't give rights to the women, but there are more women accepting Islam than men. Do you know that? Throughout the world, in Europe, more women accepting Islam. In India, more women accepting Islam. Even in Singapore, it will be the same case. If you take the statistic maybe from MCA, they'll be in a better position to tell you about Singapore. But throughout the world, there are more women accepting Islam. Though the Western world is attacking Islam, the major point is they don't give rights to women. But that is only theoretical. Practically, there is no religion in the world except Islam which gives total rights to the woman. So because if you analyze sister logically and scientifically, Islam is the best way of life, therefore it is spreading. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the glorious Quran, in Surah Al-Imran chapter 3 verse number 19, Inna dina inda Allah al-Islam, the only religion acceptable in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Islam. And Allah gives the promise in the glorious Quran thrice. In Surah Tawbah chapter number 9 verse number 33, in Surah Saf chapter number 61 verse number 9, as well as in chapter 48 verse 28, Allah says, "Huwa alladhi arsala rasulahu bil huda wa dinil haq liyuzhirahu 'ala ad-dini kulli." Walau karihal mushrikun. That Allah has sent his messenger with guidance and the religion of truth so that it will prevail over all the other ways of life, over all the other religion, over all the other isms. Islam is destined to supersede all, master them all, overcome them all, however much the mushrik don't like it. And once Allah says that waqafa billahi shahida, and enough is Allah as a witness. So Allah said that he has given this religion of truth and sent a messenger with guidance so that it will prevail over all the other religions. Islam is the only religion, and Quran is the only religious scripture which has the solution to the problems of mankind. That's the reason it is the fastest religion. Hope that answers the question.
I've got a question here, whether non-Muslims will go to heaven, and what about the case of Mother Teresa?
The question posed was that will non-Muslims go to heaven, and what about Mother Teresa? The reply to this question, who will go to heaven, Jannah, is given in Surah Al-Asr, chapter 103, verse number 1 to 3, which says, Wal Asr, Inna al-insana lafi khusr, illa alladhina amanu, wa amilu salihati, wa tawasaw bil haqqi, wa tawasaw bil sabr. That by the token of time, man is verily in a state of loss, except those who have faith, those who have righteous deed, those who exhort people to truth, and those who exhort people to patience and perseverance. The minimum criteria is required for any human being to go to Jannah is 4. Have faith, iman, have righteous deed, exhort people to truth, to dawah and islah, exhort people to patience and perseverance. If any one of these 4 criteria are missing, you shall not enter Jannah. You may be a very good Muslim. You may have performed hajj, you may be offering salah, you may have kept past 3 months of Ramadan, but if you don't do dawah, you shall not enter Jannah. All 4 criteria are equally important. Iman, righteous deed, exhorting people to truth, dawah and islah, and exhorting people to patience and perseverance. If anyone is missing, you shall not enter Jannah. So any human being wants to go to Jannah, heaven, you should fulfill all these criteria. Let's take the example of Mother Teresa. You know, we learn and we hear that she got the Nobel Prize, and you know, she has done many good deeds, etc. You know, people have given an award, Nobel Prize. We hear in the newspaper, so maybe you say righteous deed, you know, she gets a high level, righteous deed. You make it high level. Exhorting people to truth, what's the degree? You know, I'm coming from Bombay. I'm an Indian. You know, I have seen many of her organization, and many people can tell you the inside story. There was a person, I think he was a European, from UK, I think, if I'm not mistaken. He wrote a book on Mother Teresa, her inside story, and that book was telling all the negative points that she is the person who has misled so many people, etc. But that Allah knows the best. I leave it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But they are mainly missionary activities they do. They do missionary activities. And how do they help the poor? And the ultimate goal is to convert them to Christianity I can say because I know I'm living in Bombay and many of us centers are in Bombay. But regarding whether she'll go to heaven or not. See, suppose if you want to pass a school. If you want to pass standard 10, suppose there are six subjects. Maths, geography, English, history, science, and whatever it is, there are six subjects. And you may score 99 out of 105. But if you fail in one, will you pass standard 10? Will you, yes or no? Yes or no? You'll fail. You have to pass in all the six subjects. Similarly, to go to Jannah, you should pass in all four. If anyone is missing, you may get 100 marks in any one particular aspect. I'm not saying that Mother Teresa got 100 marks in righteousness. I'm not telling that. So don't misunderstand me. But surely she didn't have iman. If anyone is missing, you shall not go to Jannah. Even a Muslim who's born in a Muslim family, if he feels he's got the ticket to heaven, it's a misconception. Just by being born in a Muslim family, being called as Muhammad or Zakir or Sultan, you don't get a ticket to heaven. You have to follow all the four criteria: iman, righteous deed, exhorting people to truth, exhorting people to patient perseverance. So any human being, whether it be Mother Teresa, whether it be Sultan, whether it be Muhammad, whether it be Abdullah, whoever it is, or Tom, Dick and Harry, if they fulfill these four criteria, inshallah, they'll go to Jannah. If anyone is missing, under normal circumstances, they shall not go to Jannah. Hope that answers the question.
Yes, brother.
Islam has fought in the past and present also against a lot of number of social ills. So one of the most tragic social systems which existed in the past was the slavery system. Even though Islam has uplifted the status of slaves in the past, it did not abolish completely the slavery systems from the earth.
So brother asked a very good question, that Islam has taken away many of the social evils like alcohol, drugs, etc. And one of the great social evil is slavery. And rightly said that Islam was the major benefactor where slavery is concerned. It gave rights to slaves, etc. But why didn't it abolish completely? There are many things that were abolished by Islam. It came in stages. Some were abolished on the spot, some in stages. For example, if you know how alcohol was prohibited, it came in stages. The first time Quran speaks about alcohol was for a Baqarah chapter 2, verse number 219, that when they ask the concerning intoxicants and gambling, tell them in it is profit and loss. The loss is more than profit. The first verse regarding intoxicants was that in it is more loss and less profit. It didn't ban it completely. Next verse of intoxicants, Surah Nisa chapter 4, verse 43, that do not pray with your mind befogged unless you can understand. That means while praying, you should not have intoxicants. More restrictions. And the final prohibition came in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 90, which says, Ya ayyuhallazina amanu, O you who believe, innamal khamru wal maisuru, most certainly intoxicants and gambling, wal anzabu wal azlamu, dedication of stones, divination of arrows, rushtum min amali shaitan, these are Satan's handiwork. Fashtanibu lalakum tuflihun, abstain from this handiwork that you may prosper. After this verse, intoxicants was totally abolished. It was haram for you to have. Now, slavery was very much ingrained in the culture of the Arabs at that time. So again, the abolition of slavery came in stages. Initially, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that even they are human beings, give them rights. If you have to marry them in mahar, give their freedom, etc., 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 slowly, slowly. But there are various verses saying the free the slaves, etc., help them, give them charity, etc. But there's no direct verse in the Quran itself which totally prohibits. The reason for the total abolition of slavery was it was supposed to be abolished afterwards. Because it was so much ingrained that most of the things which came as completely, alhamdulillah, during the time of the Prophet it was fulfilled. But certain things, if you read scholars, they have given their comments and they say that this was so much ingrained that Islam set the ball rolling and the final outcome was supposed to take place maybe a few decades or a few years after the death of the beloved Prophet. Many things took place while he was alive. This abolition of slavery, Islam set the ball rolling and saw to it that it was completed, if not during the time of the Prophet, at least after that. Therefore, if you read in the Quran, there are several verses praising the slave, giving them the rights, etc. So it was so much ingrained, it was so much there in the society that it was supposed to be stopped maybe a few years after the death of the beloved Prophet. Hope that answers the question.
Speak louder, Imran.
I have two questions which is intertwined. Okay? Okay, I agree with you that much of the distortion of the Islamic image is done by the Western media, but at the same time, I also think that much of it is caused by the Muslims themselves. See, I think if we understand that according to the Christian scriptures, it says that Jesus said that by the fruits you shall know them. So that by the fruits you shall know them. So that is why they are judging us by the products that we produce. So my question number one is, how much have the Muslims actually done to actually project a healthy image of Islam? Okay. And then I met with an American friend of mine, and he says that, you see, the Muslims, they are always judging on us, the West. Okay. They are always saying that we are low in morals and such. But what the West needs is actually a solution to it. And then he said that when he ponders upon the Muslim countries, there is so much corruption in Pakistan, there is so much violence in the Middle East, that it doesn't give a healthy image of Islam. Okay? So he was pondering, how much does bringing Islam to the West will make sure that it will not fall into the same category as the Muslim countries? So Dr. Zakir, my next question is, while the da'is are traveling around the world to spread the good image of Islam, how much are these da'is actually doing to actually correct the Muslims' misconceptions themselves and talk to people like Osama Laden or to the Taliban, etc., and say to them that, look, no matter how good your intention is, what you are doing is damaging to Islam. Thank you.
But there are two questions. The first question that, you know, if you see that there are many Muslims who are bad, Pakistan, corruption is there, etc., the Islam, the major is spoiled. So he's asking the question that the non-Muslims mainly pick up these people and they say that, you know, if Islam is good, then how come the Muslims are bad? And I believe I've given the answer to this question. If you heard my second last answer, it's the same answer, that don't judge a car by the driver. Don't judge Islam by what Muslims are doing. What they're doing, they're picking up black sheep and portraying them. Corruption in Pakistan, Muslim country, who says a Muslim country? Muslim country means follow the Quran and the Sunnah. Muslim in namesake can be possible. I know that there is corruption in Pakistan. I've been to Pakistan. But just because there's corruption, that doesn't mean that Muslims are corrupt as a whole. Yes, few people in Pakistan may be corrupted. There may be more. But if they're corrupt, go to the Quran. Quran says in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse 188, that do not squander your wealth on vanities. Do not use your wealth as a bait for the judges, in order you may eat other people's wealth. Bribery is haram in Islam. Your second question. What are the da'is doing to remove this misconception from the Muslims? Why are they making the better Muslims? Brother, I can speak on my behalf. I can't speak on the other da'is. Alhamdulillah, if you see my cassettes, I have spoken on these topics, women's rights in Islam, Al-Quran, Sharif, that is understanding, deity laws. My topics are both address non-Muslims as well as Muslims, making them more aware. Many Muslims don't even know the rights which Islam gives to the woman. Many Muslims, leave aside non-Muslims. So I educate them also, and I do dawah, Islam and dawah together. Regarding values, you can refer to my video cassette, Islam Introduction, where I've given the basic values. I've spoken not to bribe, not to have alcohol, not to cheat, etc. Quran says in Surah Ghasha, chapter number 88, verse number 21, فَذَكِّرِنَّ مَانْتَ مُذَكِّرْ. For your job, O Prophet, is to deliver the message, admonish them. You are not a person who's going to look into their affairs. Our job is to deliver the message. Whether anyone accepts Islam or not, that's in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our job is to deliver the message. I have delivered you the message. Whether you follow or not, that's your problem. So our job as da'is is to deliver the message of Islam in the best way we can, with hikmah. Whether you agree or not, Allah will question you. Regarding telling Osama bin Laden and Taliban what they're doing is damaging Islam, etc. Brother, that is your view. That is your view that Osama bin Laden and Taliban, they're damaging Islam. See, for the haq, you mentioned the glorious Quran in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse 135, it says that, Ya ayyuhal ladzina amanu, O you believe, stand out firmly for justice as witness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if it be against yourself, against your parents, against your kith and kin, whether it be the poor or the rich, Allah protects both. Now what we read in the papers, the Taliban is bad, Taliban is good, you know, we read in the paper, oh, Taliban, they are ill-treating the women, etc. I am not a person who is expert on politics. I'm a da'i. I'm not expert on politics. But there are experts. If you ask my view about Taliban, you know, Quran says in Surah Hujurat, chapter 49, verse number 6, that before you pass on the message, you verify whether it's right or wrong. I read in the papers that the Taliban, oh, they are very ruthless people, you know, they said all women should stop working. They should stop working and they should sit at home. Finish. I read it. Right or wrong? Allahu alam. I read the news from America. In Taliban, they said that it is not good for the women to go out and work because the atmosphere is not modest. We will see to it that they receive their salary at the doorstep. If my sister was living in Afghanistan, and if someone tells me,
"Heaven makes me want her even more."
At the doorstep, is it good or bad? If your sister was there in Afghanistan, and if someone says, "You know, the atmosphere there outside is bad, we'll give your sister salary at doorstep without working," which would you prefer? I'm not telling which news, I don't know which news is correct. So I'm not saying Taliban is good or bad. I get two different news. But before you ever make a comment that teach these people, Allah will question you. Did you check up the news? So you as a Muslim saying that Osama bin Laden is right or wrong, have you checked up? What we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide them on the straight path. You know, as I said, bombing in Nigeria, American consulate, Osama bin Laden, headline. Did or not? We don't know. But if you ask my view, if he's on the truth, if he's fighting the enemies of Islam, I'm for him. I don't know what he's doing. I'm not in touch with him. I don't know him personally. I read newspapers. If he's terrorizing the terrorist, if he's terrorizing America, the terrorist, biggest terrorist, I'm with him. Every Muslim should be a terrorist. The thing is that if he's terrorizing a terrorist, he's following Islam. Whether he is or not, I don't know. So don't go and tell outside that Zakir Naik is for Osama bin Laden. I am with him if he's terrorizing the terrorist. I am with him and I'll do duas for him. If he's not, I'm against him. I don't know what he is. I cannot base my judgment as a Dai only on news. But you as a Muslim, without checking up, laying allegations also wrong. So I am with those people who are following the Quran. Even if the full world is against them, I'm with them. You know, because Quran says in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 160, it says that if Allah helps you, no one can overcome you. If Allah forsakes you, who will help you then? So let the believers put their trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Thank you. There's a question here. It says, if Allah is merciful, why did He create hell? And why is there so much of punishment described in the Quran?
The question posed was that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is merciful, then why did He punish people? Why did He create hell? And I do agree that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is merciful. Every chapter of the glorious Quran, every surah, except for Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, begins with the beautiful formula, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. But at the same time, besides being merciful, the glorious Quran says in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 40, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is never unjust in the least degree. Besides being merciful, He's also very just. Now both these criteria, if you analyze, He's merciful and just. Now, in order to be merciful and just, sometimes He may also have to punish certain people. You know, for example, there's a person who rapes a woman. If someone rapes my sister and someone says, "Oh, God is so merciful, He has forgiven the rapist," what will I do? Will I praise Allah? What will I do? See, Allah is merciful. Allah is merciful, at the same time, just. So if He has to be merciful to me or to the woman who has been raped, what He has to do? He should punish the rapist. Whether He punishes in this world or the hereafter, Quran says in Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verse 185, that the final recompense shall be paid on the day of judgment. So, if He has to be just and merciful, He will also have to punish certain people. And in that punishment, in the long run, He's also just to that person. For example, if an examination is taking place, and the teacher catches one person copying, then the student says, "But teacher, you're so merciful." Teacher says, "Okay, you continue copying, I'm merciful." What will the other students do? What will they say? "Oh, teacher is so good. You know, she's allowing that student to copy." They will say, "Oh, we slogged out day and night. And this colleague of ours, this student, he's copying. Teacher's biased." They won't praise the teacher. And if they come to know teacher is always going to allow copying, you know what will happen? Everyone will start copying. Next examination, no one will study. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that whether you commit sin or not, I will put you in heaven. You know, there will be no hell in the hereafter, but this world will become a hell. Won't it? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is merciful, at the same time just, and because He is merciful and just, He also has to give punishment to certain people. But that doesn't mean that you have to lose hope. You have to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you made mistake, Allah will punish you if you don't repent. But if you repent, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will surely forgive you. And Allah shows you the ways how to repent. Basically, there are four criteria of repentance. First, you have to agree what you're doing is wrong. Suppose you did something wrong. You're having alcohol. Agree it is wrong. Stop it immediately. Point number two. Point number three, don't do it in future. And point number four, if your act has caused harm to someone, see to it you repay that person. If you have robbed something, then give that material back to him. So if you repent, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will inshallah forgive you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created hell and heaven because Quran says in Surah Mulk chapter 67 verse number 2 that Allah has created death and life to test which of you is good in deeds. He has created death and life to test which of you is good in deeds. This life is a test for the hereafter. It is like you telling a teacher, teacher, why have you kept the fail? Only keep first class. Why have you kept second class, third class and fail? So if the teacher has only first class, then where is the test? If everyone is going to get first class, then where is the test? So Allah says this world that you're living is a test for the hereafter. If you pass this test, you go to heaven. If you fail, you go to hell. In all ways, alhamdulillah, Allah is the most merciful. He's just and He's even severe in giving punishment if you require it. Hope that answers the question. Sister, please.
In Islam, right, we have hadith which is interpreted by different imam. And this led to confusion because some of my friends asked, like, if we have different hadiths, right, and some of them are different, as in, you know, like one imam said that when we take the wudu, at least three strands of hair, and while others that, you know, the whole head, right? Okay, some of them said that we are indecisive, as in we undecisive, as in we cannot come up with one hadith. What can we say about this? And, okay, another question is that my teacher said something about that God is cruel because Habil and Qabil, right, because they had an argument and one of them killed the one. Okay, so how can I correct my teacher? She said something like, God is cruel because of this act.
Okay. This was the first question was that there are different mazhabs, and that covers my 17th common question. I said, why are there so many sects, etc.? Regarding your question that whether the hair should be completely by wudu, etc., why are they different? Why can't they one hadith? Sister, in following the hadith, first check up the authenticity of the hadith. If it is sahih, you have to follow. If it is zaif, you don't have to follow. There are sahih hadith, zaif hadith, and mawzu hadith. If it's a sahih, you have to follow. If it's not a sahih, you don't have to follow. No two sahih hadith will contradict. And there is a science of hadith, which you have to go through years of studies and how to analyze that. Regarding difference of madhabs, you said, sister asked a question, what are the difference of madhab, which madhab to follow? Is that a question? So the question, which madhab to follow? You know, there are various things. And the answer is given in the glorious Quran in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 103, which says, وَاتَسِيمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعُوا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. Hold to the rope of Allah strongly and be not divided. Which is the rope of Allah? This. Hold to the rope of Allah strongly and be not divided. Hold to the glorious Quran and the Sahih Hadith and be not divided. It is forbidden for the Muslims to be divided amongst ourselves. And the glorious Quran says in Surah An'am chapter 6 verse 159 that anyone who divides the religion and breaks it into sects, you have nothing to do with them. Allah tells the Prophet, you have nothing to do with them. Allah will look after their affairs and He will tell them the truth in the end. That means dividing the religion of Islam into sects is haram in Islam. But when you ask a person, what are you? Some person say, I'm a Hanafi. Some person say, I'm a Shafi. Some say, I'm a Maliki. Some say, I'm a Deobandi. Some say, I'm a Jamaat-e-Islami. Some say I'm a Barevli. What are the beloved Prophet? Hanafi? Was he Shafi? Was he Deobandi? What was he? You are the Muslim. Quran says in Surah Al-Imran chapter 3 verse 52, Eesa alayhi salam was a Muslim. Quran says in Surah Al-Imran chapter 3 verse 67 that Abraham, peace be upon him, was not a Jew or a Christian, he was a Muslim. Our beloved Prophet was a Muslim. The Quran gives the answer in Surah Fusilat. Chapter 41, verse number 33. وَمَنْ أَحَسُنُ قَالَ مِمَّنْ ضَاءِ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَآمَلَ الصَّالِحَمْ قَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Who is better in speech than one who invites to the way of thy Lord, works righteousness and says that I am a Muslim? I am the one who bows to the will of Islam. So if anyone poses the question, what are you? You should say I'm a Muslim. All these imams, alhamdulillah, I respect them all. They were great imams. Imam Shafi, Abu Hanifa, may Allah be pleased with them. Imam Malik, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, may Allah be pleased with them all. They were great scholars. I respect them. If someone follows their particular views, I've got no objection. You know, you, some person says Imam Shafi, may Allah be pleased with him, is right here. Imam Abu Hanifa is right here. Alhamdulillah, I've got no objection. But if someone asks you the question, what are you? You should say, I'm a Muslim. If you don't follow that, you're going against the Quran. You can't call yourself a Hanafi or a Shafi or a Maliki. You should call yourself as a Muslim. You may agree with the views of certain scholars. I've got no objection. But if the view of that scholar goes against the Quran and the Hadith, you have to reject that view. Let him be the greatest scholar in the world. If it goes against the Quran and the Sahih Hadith, you have to reject the view of that scholar. People may pose the question, you know what our beloved Prophet said? There'll be 73 firqas, 73 sects. What do you have to say about that? There's a hadith in Abu Dawood. It's mentioned, hadith number 4579. It says that a beloved Prophet said that the religion of Islam will divide into 73 sects. A Prophet said there will be 73 sects. He didn't say you should make 73 sects. There will be, he's predicting. That though the Quran says don't make sects, you Muslims are bound to make sects. And there's another hadith mentioned in Tirmidhi, hadith number 171, that a beloved Prophet said, there will be 73 sects in Islam. Out of that, only one will be on the true path. So the companion asked, which sect will be on the true path? The Prophet said, that sect which follows me and my companions, which follow the Quran and the Sahih Hadith. So if you are the Muslim sister, you should follow the Quran and the Sahih Hadith. If you have difference of opinion, this scholar says that, if it matches with the Quran, you agree with that scholar. If it goes against the Quran, you reject that scholar. And most of your problem will be solved. The problem that we have today is because we don't read the Quran with understanding. If you read the Quran with understanding, most of your problem will be solved. Hope that answers the question. Regarding a second question, that the teacher said that Almighty God is cruel. One brother kills the other brother. The sons of Adam, peace be upon him. Sister, tell your teacher that God Almighty didn't tell one brother to kill the other brother. Allah says in the glorious Quran, Surah Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 32, that if anyone kills any human being, unless it be for murder or for creating mischief in the land, it is as though you have killed the whole of humanity. Quran doesn't say if you kill a Muslim, any human being, Muslim or non-Muslim, if you kill any human being, unless it be man, it is as though you have killed the whole of humanity. And if you save any human being, it is as though you have saved the whole humanity. So Almighty God says you should not kill any human being unless he's creating mischief, he's causing disturbance, he's trying to see to it that peace doesn't prevail. In that case, you can. Otherwise, you should not kill any living creature. That is just the story of a couple of brothers who killed each other. Allah didn't tell them to kill. And Allah is not cruel. Allah is merciful. He is just and even punishes those who require punishment. Hope that answers the question.
Alhamdulillah. You were saying that just now, salam is peace. Can we Muslims give salams to the non-Muslims?
Okay, be a short answer. Very good question. Brother said short answer. The complete answer, brother, refer to my video cassette. If the label shows your intent, wear it. Regarding the reply, can you wish peace? The answer is given in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 86. It says that if anyone greets you courteously, greet back more courteously or at least the same. For Allah is careful on keeping of accounts. If anyone wishes you assalamu alaikum, you have to say wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. Someone says peace be on you, say peace and blessings be on you. If someone says assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, you have to say wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. May peace, blessings and mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on you. You have to wish back more courteously. Someone says assalamu alaikum, you say wa alaikum assalam. The wording is the same, but yet it is coming from within that, that's better. And Allah says in the Quran, wish back more courteously. So surely according to this, if some non-Muslim wishes you, you can also wish them back more courteously. And regarding can you wish them? There is a hadith in Sahih Muslim, various hadith, which says that when the non-Muslim wish you, then say, alaikum. There's a hadith, but it's not in context. The complete context of the hadith is that when the Jews wished you, assalamu alaikum means may death be on you. So the Prophet said, when someone says, may death be on you, say, alaikum, on you too. So many people misinterpret and saying that according to the hadith, you cannot wish back salam to non-Muslim. See, if you read in the Quran, in Surah Maryam, I have to be short. Surah Maryam chapter number 19, verse number 47, that Ibrahim alayhi salam, when his father kicks him out of the house, he tells his father, Assalamu alaikum, peace be on you. I will pray to my Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive your sins. Ibrahim alayhi salam says to his father, who was a mushrik, Assalamu alaikum. Quran says Surah Furqan, Surah Taha, Surah Qasas. You can refer to my cassette. That when the ignorant approach you, tell them, Kalu salama, peace be on you. So very well, brother, you can wish them salam. And if they wish you, you can even wish them back. Hope that answers the question. Wa akhru da'wana, alhamdulillah, rabbil alamin.
I must thank everyone for being patient. We have extended this lecture more than we should. Before we end, on behalf of Darul Arkam, I'd like to thank you again, and I look forward to seeing you at Darul Arkam, the Galaxy Building, for the in-house lectures. And if you've got more questions, as there are some here, please bring them again, and we will take them in Galaxy. With that, we'll end the session with Tasbih Kafara and Suratul As. Subhanakallahumma. أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك والأسر بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والأسر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر صدق الله العظيم السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته